Shalom. This is Quay, and I'm happy to be here to share with you today from the book of Revelation, the revelation of Jesus Christ. And today we will be looking at Revelation chapter 2, verses 12 through 17. We're going to take a look at the third church in the circuit of seven churches. Today, we will begin to look at Pergamum. Some translations call it Pergamos, but the translation I'm using, the Tree of Life, calls it Pergamum. So we remember that there is a blessing upon us as we study, as we hear this read aloud, and as we take to heart what the Spirit is speaking to us. Let those who have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches today. And I just want to reiterate at this point that this study of Revelation, this series, is not a scholarly study. Hopefully, I'm trying to be just true to the scripture itself and just to some simple insights that the Holy Spirit has given throughout the years and continues to give. I do encourage you, there's some really good, you know, scholarly studies, some other good teachers who bring forth things in Revelation that are outside of the scope of what we are doing in this. But at any rate, we are blessed as we study together. So we're going to go to Pergamum. Now, again, also a little refresher that in the second and third chapters of the book of Revelation, it's messages that the Lord has given to John to give to these seven specific churches in this region. In the Bible days, it was called Asia. Currently, it's what we would call modern day Turkey, is where these were located. Now, these were real churches, and they had, these were real time situations in their day that Jesus was addressing. But we also hold to the truth, and I believe the Holy Spirit bears witness that in his extravagant, manifold wisdom, God has also caused it to be that the situations in these churches that are addressed are relevant for all believers, even individually, sometimes corporately. Specific churches might be undergoing something similar to what is happening in one of these, but even for individuals throughout our lives, these situations and the Lord's words to these churches can still be very relevant to us. The way that the enemy works, the powers and principalities are the same. They just put on different clothes, and you know, our houses are a little bit different, and you know, there's some of those superficial things are different, but the basic heart matter is the same. Now, I would like to just give a little bit of an overview of this city that we're going to be studying and what the external situation was for the believers that were there. So Pergamum had been a center of Greek culture for many years. It contained a magnificent library that had about 200,000 volumes. They were written on very exquisite parchment that was actually produced there at Pergamum. So this was a rarity in, you know, the world at that time, that they would have that magnificent library. So very intellectual. Now, they were also very politically astute, because after the Roman government took over the globalization at that time of the world, they were pretty smart in Pergamum, and they became the first capital of the Roman province there. They were the first city to embrace emperor worship, which was pushed by the Roman government to worship the Caesar, is, you know, what the leader of that empire was called. And so in order to ingratiate themselves to the Romans, the governing factors in the secular realm of Pergamum went along with these things with Rome. There was a very famous temple there. It was dedicated to a very chief god in the pagan world, Zeus. We will be talking more about that in future sessions. And then also there was a temple to a Greco-Roman god, a god that the two cultures shared, even the name. I don't know that I can pronounce his name properly, but Aesculapius, it was a god of healing. And so just to give a little bit of overview, now I'm gonna go ahead and read through the entire passage of verses 12 through 17. And then we'll go back and we'll begin to look more closely verse by verse. Hallelujah. Thank you for your word, Lord. To the angel of Messiah's community in Pergamum, write, thus says the one, capital O, who has the sharp two-edged sword. I know where you live, where Satan's throne is. Yet you continue to hold firm to my name, and you did not deny your faith in me, even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was killed among you, where Satan resides. But I have a few things against you. You have some there who hold the teaching of Balaam, who was teaching Balak to put a stumbling block before B'nai Yisrael, that's the children of Israel, to eat food sacrificed to idols and to commit sexual immorality. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Repent then. If not, I will come to you soon and make war against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Ruach, the Spirit, is saying to Messiah's communities. To the one who overcomes, I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone, and written on the stone, a new name that no one knows except the one who receives it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We'll go back and we will begin to look more closely. Now, if you will recall, there's a format that is followed for these letters, and it starts out with the salutation to the angel or the messenger of Messiah's community in Pergamum. So it's very clear who this is to at that time. However, like we said, we can take it personally today and see if there be anything in our heart that is parallel to what's going on in Pergamum. Maybe, maybe not, but either way, we can have this in our understanding and be watchful as we go through our lives. Also, we want to remember that it was directed by John that all of this this entire prophecy, which is from chapter 1 all the way through the end of chapter 22, that the entire prophecy, he called it one prophecy, would be read to all the churches. So each church heard what was said to the other churches. Okay, thus says the one, it's in capital letters in my Bible, the one who has the sharp two-edged sword. Now remember, the Lord identifies himself in a specific way with some specific descriptive characteristics of how, you know, he appears or what his character is, and it goes back to chapter 1. I encourage you to refer to chapter 1 frequently as you're reading through this book as a reminder of how Jesus in his glorified, ascended manifestation as the one who is the overseer of his church and who is worthy and has earned the right to not only commend them, but to bring correction. And so he describes himself as the one who has the sharp two-edged sword. And John saw, when he perceived Jesus, he said, oh, he has a sharp double-edged sword coming out of his mouth. Now, literally, Jesus Christ does not have a sword coming out of his mouth. But when John perceived him, he understood that whenever this one would speak, it was that he would be speaking eternally the living, active Word of God. And in Hebrews, it says the Word of God is living, active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It is able to penetrate into our very being through the spirit and the soul, discerning and laying bare all of the secrets of the heart. And we probably have secrets in our heart that we are not even conscious about. It requires this inspection by the living God. And so he identified himself as the one with the sword. We're going to wrap up this session in just a moment, but I'll say just a couple more things about perhaps why he gave them this description of himself. One was, remember we said that they lived under a very intense oversight by the Roman government. And the Roman government was known to rule by the sword and to enforce their laws by the sword. And so one thing that Jesus was probably saying was, I have a sword that is greater than that sword that you are living under. I'm the one you should fear, not the sword of the Roman government. Now, you should respect as long as, you know, they're not asking you to do something that is antithema to your faith. Paul said, you know, we have respect for that government, but we do not fear it like we fear the Lord. And so the Lord was saying, I'm stronger than that Roman government. But I believe as we read on, we've already read it today, and as we study, we will find out that one of the problems here was false teachers. And so they would be speaking things out of their mouth that was not the truth. And the Lord is saying, I am the only one who speaks the truth, and I'm going to come and deal with these. I'm going to come and deal with you speaking truth. Aren't we glad the Lord speaks truth? So, praise the Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this word. God bless you. We'll see you next time.